Last week's American Black Film Festival, I sat down with Benny Boom, the director of Tupac movie, All Eyes on Me. Here's our conversation.
Talk Tupac, man.
What's up, man? How you doing?
I'm doing great. Glad to have you here. Fellow Alpha man.
Yeah.
That's how we do
you
it.
Know how we do it.
There are very few rappers who, this many years after their death, still commands this fascination and respect as Tupac.
Yeah, I can't think of any like this. You know, it's almost a religion. The people that love Pac, that didn't know him or only know him a certain way or through the music, and they're so attached to him. And, you know, in beginning of the project, it was like, you know, I was always a fan of Pac, but there are people out there that call themselves like Tupacologists. You know, they know what he ate on certain days, and it's crazy, you know. So it's a real thing. Like, people really, really have invested parts of their life into this man.
This ain't just about you. Like all black men, you have a bullseye on your back. They are gonna come after you and everything you love. They are gonna give you the tools that you need to destroy yourself.
I was reading, there was a book written by one of his bodyguards. Mm-hmm. And
Frank.
Yeah, and he laid out, literally, this guy did most of his career damage in an extremely short window.
Yeah.
Where literally he was going from recording to the movie set, back to recording. I mean, it was just like this very short window.
Yeah, it's amazing. You know, I think that the trajectory of his life was changed in New York in Quad. At the shooting, you know, when he was shot 5 times, it changed his life. I mean, that would change anybody's life. You know, you should shot and survive. But I think that, you know, before that, he had a mission, you know, a mission statement, son of a Panther. And he was, you know, given all this tutelage. And if you hear the music, you know, he was talking about the positive things, also street stuff and things that were going on in rap and then. But, you know, the message changed. You know, and you understand why the message changed, because he went through something that really, for all intents and purposes, could have ended his life.
Well, that, also prison.
In prison
and
time,
all of that.
All this stuff. So being that young, and we also got to remember, at that time, he's 23 years old, at that time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you think about, I know what I was doing at 23, that's a lot of pressure on somebody. And to have to be creative afterwards and then have to go out into the public afterwards and make music. And how are you not going to make music when all he always spoke was his own truth and always spoke how he felt? Some people didn't like it, but it was real.
It's interesting that we are now operating in this space of, if you take Straight Out of Compton, you take this movie.
Yeah.
I read Luther Campbell's book, and I'm telling you
right
now.
Yeah, they're making a movie out of
it. No, the moment I read it, I said on the air, this will be a movie.
Yeah, I heard about
that. I read that book literally in 48 hours.
Wow.
It's an amazing book. And so when you look at so many other black artists where it took decades. I mean, we just got Get On Up, the James Brown film.
I know.
You take Ray Charles as well, which took forever.
Yeah.
It seems this generation is coming of age saying, no. We ain't waiting 30 or 40 years to be able to tell these stories.
Well, everything is immediate now, right? So the moment that you say something or have a conversation, you can see it on Twitter, you can film yourself, and it's out there. So the gratification of people is different. It's shorter. Like, our generation, you know, we could wait around for things. We could sit through commercials. This generation can't sit through commercials at all. You know, so their attention span is short.
Even though the commercial was paying for what you watching.
What was you watching? So the attention span is a lot shorter. So they hunger for this material, you know, right now. It has to be right now. So,
were you under personal pressure telling this particular story as a director?
Yeah.
Knowing full well how folks feel about Tupac.
Yeah, of course, because it's a lot of pressure from all kinds of sides. You know, it's amazing because he touched a lot of people's lives, you know, and so in order to tell the story, you have to figure out what story are we telling, because we can't tell every single piece of everything. So the movie, you know, the story we told was really about those things, the trials and tribulations of his life, and those incidents that put him in the car that night with Suge. You know, the story is, you know, we talk about it's three parts: it's who Tupac was, who Tupac had to be, and who Tupac wanted to be. You know.
His mom didn't live long enough to be able to see this film.
I know.
What, as you were going through trying to make it. Mm-hmm. Was she a part of that process?
She was a part in the beginning. And then right. when I got hired, you know, I came on, actually, there were, they had already started pre-production. So mm-hmm. they had started some scouting and stuff like that. And then the producer and the director at the time parted ways. And I got a call, and like the night, like Thanksgiving before of 2015. And I had read the script. I had read a different version of the script mm-hmm. before, and this was a totally different version. I read it, and I was really intrigued by the framing device that's used to tell his story and how it unfolds. And so at the time, I was, you know, it's like, hey, man, I'm down for it, you know? So when I got on the job, I was told at the time that Mr. Shakur wasn't really in the best of health. And then, of course, we saw, like, right after we finished shooting, you know, she passed away, which mm. was, it was devastating for us because we wanted, always wanted to do, like, a full rough cut, take it up to, because she was living in Northern California, take it up there, sit with her, let her see it, and just, you know, let her see the work that mm-hmm. we've done, especially because Demetrius, the kid that plays her, looks so much like
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, we...
I mean, I had him on set, and I'm going, okay, yeah, dude, yeah. you look...
But it's more than look, though. He, man, it's amazing because I had a chance to see his audition tapes, and he auditioned and he did what they call chemistry reads. So he read with different people for different parts of the movie, and I'm watching, I'm like, wow, this is crazy.
You are the Omega of my heart, the foundation for my conception of love. When I think of what a black woman should be, it's you that I first think of.
It didn't feel like acting. Mm-hmm. You know, he just embodied it. He was young. You could tell that he had watched all this stuff about Pac and just soaked it up.
So the one thing you want somebody who wasn't alive, mm-hmm. Tupac was alive, mm-hmm. to walk away with when this film is done. I want if he's watching it.
Yeah, I just want them to understand. Sorry, I just want them to understand. Take away the mythology of Tupac. This was a man. You know, murdered tragically at 25 years old. He had a lot left to say. Mm-hmm. And I think watching this film, I would love, especially for us in our community, these young black brothers that are out here killing each other, and they might be in rap, but they might not be in rap, but it's just the lifestyle that's being led right now. I just want everybody to take a look at this. This guy was, you know, Pac was a shining star in the world. And I'm not just talking about rap star, I'm talking a star amongst other people. And I want people to see this film and walk away just thinking a little bit about themselves and about what can I do better? Look what this man did in 25 short years of his life. What am I doing? Where am I? What could I be doing for the betterment of all of us?
Well, All Eyes on Me is in theaters now. Yeah. All eyes gonna be on you.
Yeah, yeah. It's all right.
So you're gonna handle it?
I can handle it. I'm an alpha man. I can handle it.
That's how you do it.
Pledge solo too. So.
Oh yeah, oh absolutely.
Weekdays on TV One.
I will never lie to you.
Oh my God.
Roland Martin.
He doesn't want to talk to us. He wants to ignore us.
Uncensored.
Hell no! No. That ain't gonna cut it, boo.
Unapologetic.
No, that is fundamentally false. You are wrong.
Unfiltered.
He wants an America where we all look alike. He ain't talking about black people.
Unrelenting.
You better go work out, because you got a fight on your hands.
News One Now with Roland Martin, weekdays at 7 a.m. on TV One.